Welcome, welcome, welcome everyone to the Option Menu Crew podcast. We are on episode 10 now, so that's pretty exciting. You've got your host, Lawrence. sorry, I got that back up. I'm too excited. Your regular host, Ryan, me, and we also have Lawrence with us today. Lawrence, how are you doing? I think maybe I'm going to make you the host now.
I'm good. I apparently have a promotion. I'll accept this promotion and I'll do my best to be the host
Excellent.
Of the Option Menu Crew.
Excellent, because the check's in the mail and I can't really return it, so it's, you know, so that's good. I'm glad you accepted. I hope it wasn't too much. I got to take a vacation and all that. No.
I'd like to thank my parents. I'd like to thank the Academy, you know.
yes, thanks all around. But yeah, having a little fun with Flub there. But today, we're having another really great topic. Me and Lawrence are going to discuss anime video games. This includes both games that are based off of anime, as well as just games that also use an anime art style and our interests and stuff around that and history and all that fun stuff. But before that, I thought it'd be a great idea to include Lawrence a little bit on the last topic we did in episode 9, which was movie and TV adaptations of video games. So that would be properties where they were originally a video game and then were turned into a TV or movie series. So
this is gonna be painful.
Yeah, we acknowledged fully on the previous episode it's a very mixed history, but we managed to have a lot of fun and there's actually a lot of hope, and it really was spurred by the fact that there are more and more projects coming out. Lawrence, did you have a chance to see the first trailer for Capcom's Monster Hunter live action movie starring Mila Jovovich?
I did not get to see the trailer, unfortunately. I'm actually need to check that out as soon as we're done with this.
So starting out on a bright note there, I actually did watch the trailer, and while I had zero hopes for it based on the few little teaser images we had, although there was one image of a dude who clearly looked like he was wearing real Monster Hunter gear, which was kind of a good sign, but it is the same director who did the live-action Resident Evil movies, and once again, Mila Jovovich. So they're kind of going as a pair, as Mila is the wife of the director, Wes Anderson, I believe is his name. So I saw the trailer, and actually, after seeing the trailer, it looks like it's going to be pretty decent, and I thought about it more, and actually, Monster Hunter's premise really, I think, lends itself to like a Hollywood blockbuster, even if it isn't fully adapted with all the respect that you'd hope that a movie like that would have. But I think you could really make it. So yeah, take a look and then we'll follow up on that outside the podcast. But to date, what are like three of your favorite adaptations that you've seen so far?
You mean from video games to movies?
Yeah, right? Like for example, the Castlevania Netflix series.
Well, those are more animations. I wouldn't really classify them as movies. When I think of movies, I think of the catastrophe that Dragon Ball was, or
But Dragon Ball is not a video game property, so.
Okay. My bad. Classic example would be the Tekken movie came out. Nobody really knows about that because that was like straight to video. That was
but
horrible.
I do know about that. I did bring that up.
DOA was another one.
Oh God.
So it was King of Fighters. They made Terry Bogard a middle-aged FBI agent in a bubble vest. I threw up.
Wow. So you've been more traumatized.
Bad man made Cody cry hurt. It was horrible. I do not recommend. One star on Yelp.
All right, then. Well, let me ask, what is your opinion of the original Mortal Kombat movie?
Now, that's a mixed bag of nuts. It held up, but nostalgia will carry you far. Very, mm-hmm. very far. I saw that movie. What was I, 13, 14? And I saw this movie, and it was the greatest thing. It had everything I wanted. Ninjas, mm-hmm. superpowers, and, you know, not to go to class the next day because it was a Sunday. It had everything I needed, and it was amazing. And because I felt this just awesome energy from it, from being just influenced at such a young age, I think it's carried with me. So my opinion of that is completely biased. I can't.
Well, all our opinions are biased, really. So that's fine. I was just curious because that is still basically the most well-regarded
video game adaptation
so far.
It was great. The fight scenes were done really well. Sanctum forever. I loved it. I did. Now the second one, not so much.
Yeah, and that holds true to what we were saying before as well. Now you have seen the first three seasons of the Castlevania Netflix series, correct?
I have.
And what is your opinion of the series so far?
I think it's great. I think it explores deeper into the lore, one, and it gives your characters a little bit of a personality and some depth. Now, playing the games themselves, especially the earlier NES games, you know, you just had Richard Belmont go around, you got a whip, you do some things, and you got to fight Dracula. Like, that was pretty much the main point. But later, you get a little bit, and the more you dive deeper, the more you actually feel a connection, you care about. The Netflix series gave them, like, their own just personalities to work with and something to love and something to grow. And I think the parallels between Alucard and Richter Belmont, it's their playfulness is great. It's we're frenemies, but we're not frenemies, and it's I think it's a beautiful thing to play with, and I like that, and it's very intriguing, and it beckons for me to want more. You know what I mean?
Yeah, there is a fourth season confirmed, so excited for that. And I don't know if you agree with me on this, but I'm gonna put it out there that at this time, Castlevania, the Netflix series, is probably the best video game adaptation around at this time.
You know what? I can agree. I can agree with that. Like, yeah.
Now that's taking into account also the myriad Pokemon movies, the recent Detective Pikachu movie, and also World of Warcraft, which is currently the highest grossing video game adaptation movie at this time.
I don't understand. I've seen that movie. Okay, I've seen the movie, and I feel like it was thrown together. We know everything about it, but we've never actually played the game. Let's just throw it in a pot and see what happens. That's the way I feel about it.
Okay.
But there were so many movies that were just bad. There was Alone in the Dark was a movie. Mortal Kombat Annihilation.
They did make an Alone in the Dark movie.
Yeah. What was it? Christian Slater starred in that movie, I think. And if you're old as I am, Christian Slater was like the man for like a year. Mm-hmm. Mortal Kombat Annihilation, we just talked about, was horrible.
Yeah.
House of the Dead was a movie.
They did make a House of the Dead, though I hear mixed things because that one's like super campy and it's one of those, it's kind of so bad it's good. That's the impression I've heard.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm going to go down the list if I can remember. Blood Rain was a movie, and that was like...
Oh, the UA Bulls movies, yes.
Yeah. Blood Rain was low-budget adult film. I don't care what anybody says. It was like, okay, there was Street Fighter, The Legend of Chun-Li. Remember that?
Right, yep. There's definitely more bad examples than good. And go ahead.
There was Street Fighter.
That's another so bad it's good. You can have a lot of fun watching that.
Agent 47 was a movie. Hitman,
yep. Mark brought that up, and he was really big.
Silent Hill, Max Payne, Assassin's Creed, Doom.
I actually thought Silent Hill 1 was pretty good.
Silent Hill 1 was great.
I know it's not super faithful, but I thought for what it did, it was a good adaptation.
Tomb Raider was a great movie for reasons that weren't plot related.
Yeah, Tomb Raider 1 holds up really well as like a decent Hollywood action movie. Not great, but it's watchable, you know. A lot of these movies qualify, or there's a good number of movies that qualify as at least watchable.
But there are a couple that I like, a couple that I love that I don't think were bad. Final Fantasy: The Spirits Within.
No.
No?
Spirits Within is terrible.
Okay, let me explain. Spirits Within I loved for the wow factor in the cinematic of it all. Think about the time when it came out. It came out 2001. It came out 2001, and at that time, so far as CG movies, it was amazing. Our cutscenes pretty much are better than that now, but at that time when it came out, we were like, wow. Like, it was, the story was trash. Don't get me wrong.
The thing is, yeah, the story was convoluted, but the main thing is it was a movie in Final Fantasy only in name. Like,
right,
Square made a movie and then put Final Fantasy on it.
I thought it was pretty, and that's the reason why
it is pretty.
Like it
is not a Final Fantasy movie.
No, definitely not. But at the time, visually, it wowed me. So I'm like, okay.
But that doesn't make it a good adaptation.
Well, I mean, everybody is subjective. They like different things for different reasons.
Okay, we can agree to disagree on that. But I would not, as a Final Fantasy fan, I would say that is a terrible adaptation. That is a terrible thing.
Well, we got recently, the Prince of Persia movie. I didn't mind that.
It's not too bad, except for the whitewashing.
I mean, okay, yeah, but that's a whole different argument. I mean, I'm not talking, that's a whole different argument about
whitewashing. Right, right, that's a meta element to it, but it is a problem with it. Yeah. But otherwise, I agree. I actually saw that in theaters, and I didn't think it was a bad movie, but it had its meta issue.
Of course, I don't mind things with Jake Gyllenhaal in it.
Oh, no, Jake Gyllenhaal is a fantastic actor, so that helps, but it's, once again, yeah.
But I can go on forever, so, you know, let's just leave that alone.
So that was very, it's a long rabbit hole, and actually, to use this as a segue, you should go and Google anime adaptations, or Google adaptations of video games and look at, like, the anime list, and you will see so many, like, one-shot mini anime series that are adaptations of video games. It will blow your mind. And that brings us back to our topic of today, which is anime video games. So, to start with this, I figured we'd just talk about our history with anime video games in terms of the evolution of the art. And to start with, Lawrence, can you remember what was, like, the first video game where you consciously was able to recognize it as, oh, this is an anime art style?
Okay, it would have to be, it's kind of difficult. I don't know if you remember the Breath of Fire series.
Yes, I do.
Breath of Fire 3. More, okay. Because the characters got more shapes and more designs and very anime-esque. I don't know if you remember what the characters looked like. But you had, there was a tiger character, there was obviously
I do remember Ryu. Seeing some of the, I'm going to Google it though on the side.
Yeah. But yeah, Breath of Fire 3 was one of the first games where I'm just like, okay, this is obviously anime based. And I think they did make an anime about it at some point, if I'm not mistaken.
I think there is some Breath of Fire animes, yeah.
And then a further Breath of Fire series became more and more anime looking.
Right.
So that was the first one for me. There's also Illusion of Gaia, which was for Super Nintendo.
Okay.
And it was a very, very awesome strategy RPG that I used to play. So those were the first ones that are very anime-esque.
Okay. Now, I can't remember when I actually learned the term anime and understood what it meant. But going back in my history, I think where I started to realize I was playing anime games was with Mega Man X on the Super Nintendo, because the sprite work was definitely leaning towards anime, but as you remember, Super Nintendo sprites weren't super large or super detailed. Well, depending on which game, but at least for Mega Man X, it wasn't super detailed, and as they got further, they got a little bit better. But I distinctly remember in PlayStation 1 era with Mega Man X 4, they had the anime cutscenes in them, full motion intro, and then some of the cutscenes in there. And they had much bigger sprites because with PlayStation 1, it was, you know, they could do 2D games much better than the previous generation. And that's when I think I realized, like, oh my god, this is an anime video game. And then, funny enough, Mega Man Legends as well, when I think back.
Wow.
The way their graphics look, they did very expressive, very colorful, bright anime, and it was like prototype cell shading almost, and I think those would be like the two where I really, really knew what I was seeing. Although I didn't actually consider Mega Man Legends anime art style at the time, but I now, looking back, go obviously. The one I think where I realized it was anime, or no, looking back still, was another PlayStation 1 era, and you're gonna laugh at this one: Street Fighter Alpha, or Street Fighter Zero as it's known in Japan.
Fair.
I remember distinctly playing Street Fighter Alpha 1, 2, and 3 on PlayStation and seeing the art style, the portraits of the characters, and then the sprites, and going, wow, this looks so much better than Street Fighter 2. Why didn't they just do... Why is this so much better? And not understanding at the time that they went for a much more anime style, but I loved it, and that was part of the reason I really enjoyed playing the Alpha games, was the characters looked so much better compared to Street Fighter 2, and this was also still in my ignorance, but I think around that time I was starting to understand what anime was.
Well, I remember anime from its like original, because it was Japanime at first, and then they shortened it from Japanime to anime, you know, because it's for Japanese animation. A lot of games, earlier games, even in the whole Nintendo, Super Nintendo market, even though we couldn't do them, you know, graphically because of technology at the time, but all the art books and everything else surrounded it revealed that it was heavily influenced by anime or anime-themed ideas.
Right. The box art and the instruction manual art typically showed what was intended, and then the sprites did their best to reflect that sometimes, not for every game, but with Japan. And it's important to state that the reason why anime art style was so prolific early on and then has remained prolific was because Japan was the main video game developing country back in the original eras of Nintendo, Super Nintendo, pretty much up until the previous generation of Xbox 360 and PS3, where things started to shift to Western development much stronger. And more diverse art styles started coming in that weren't anime influenced. But even today, there's still a wild number of anime games. And even in the mobile market, you've got games where, even if it's just, you know, the character portraits, they're still anime styled, and there's still a lot of stuff coming out of those Eastern countries for Japan and China and Korea are still producing a lot of that. And even some Western teams dabble with it, but not so much. They tend to diversify. So I wanted to ask off the top, what are some of your... Well, actually, I want to talk about the history of the art. So do you remember when you started seeing anime games and going like, oh man, this looks like the anime?
Let's say I have to think about this. When I started doing when I started getting better with the Dragon Quest games, now obviously the art style was inspired and contributed by Akira Toriyama, you know, of Dragon Ball.
Exactly, yes.
So when they started really getting into those characters, it instantly clicked what they were based off of, the design scheme. So I'm like, wow, this is really, really in depth. They're really trying here to make it feel more like an anime. And most RPGs or JRPGs are usually responsible and guilty for that. And speaking of guilty for that, Guilty Gear.
Yes, Guilty Gear definitely was very anime themed, though I would say that looking back at their old sprites from like the Accent Core series, they weren't still quite as detailed, so while the designs were definitely in line with traditional anime and their hard rock themes interpreted in the Japanese lens, I would definitely agree with you that the Dragon Quest 8 specifically, which is on PS2, looked really good and was very in line with it. And PS2 is that kind of awkward phase where they really were experimenting and getting better at 3D graphics, but hadn't quite mastered bring an anime look to it. And I wanted to bring up a specific example that I know you can relate to with me, which is the jump in art style from Dragon Ball Z Budokai 1 to Dragon Ball Z Budokai 2. Do you remember those two games and what they looked like?
I as a person who played a lot of Dragon Ball games, even the ones for Nintendo that were originally in Japanese and we just had to guess. But yeah, I do remember the leaps and bounds they definitely made, and I was definitely impressed. There was the Odin Sphere and Dragon Crown games.
Yes,
they were very cel shaded. They were cel shaded, but they were very anime influenced. Not only the way the designs were, but just the way the characters interacted with the world, facial expressions, and just thought bubbles. It's very, very anime.
So to go back just a little bit to explain to our viewers. So if you look up Dragon Ball Z Budokai 1, they did the weird, awkward thing where the characters didn't have any hard outlines. They were basically their pure 3D models with coloring, a mild amount of like shading inside the models, but it was mostly just regular 3D. And while the faces actually hold up and the models do look like the characters, it doesn't look like anime, which lends to this awkward feeling. And then with Budokai 2, I think they dropped down the total number of polygons on the characters, but they changed it up drastically. They brightened up the colors, they put on the hard black outlines and even and style lines inside the characters, and it just ended up feeling so much more like the anime. And they carried on that into Budokai 3 and I think the other subsequent Budokai games until Tenkaichi, where they kind of reset and changed things. And by then they were going on to new generations, so it looked different. And then speaking to the examples you brought up, Lawrence, for Odin Sphere, which was a PS2 game, and Dragon's Crown was a PS3 game. Vanillaware, I believe, is the developer. They had developed a specific style and engine where they pretty much used like watercolory rendering, but it was very much like sprites. I don't think it was full 3D. I think there's still sprites, but they're like these hand-drawn, like hand-painted sprites, and they have this technology that lets them like breathe and move and flex in a way. So it literally was like the evolution, or a type of evolution, of sprite work that seemingly only Vanillaware has mastered. And yeah, Odin Sphere is extremely beautiful to look at, not only with its characters, but with its background designs. Carried that into Odin Sphere, carried that into Muramasa, the Demon Blade.
Oh,
And
yeah.
those are them their own type. And that speaks to the variety of art styles you can even see within the anime genre of visual design. So those were great examples, and I did want to touch on those, so thank you for that. But
Not a problem.
moving backwards once again, it was very difficult to get games to look like 2D anime, like they were drawn and they were in the flat panels. And even today, it's still tough, but we've gotten closer, and certain games try and do better. And just to do service to other types of games, like Tekken, in and of itself, uses anime aesthetics and sensibilities, but it's still highly detailed. Like those characters you would describe, and they look like they look anime as all heck, wouldn't you agree?
Well, I mean, yeah, obviously, you can definitely tell it's they try to do as close as they could about keeping it anime aesthetic, but making it as realistic as humanly possible.
Right. They add in a super high level of detail, but still use anime art sensibilities in their character designs, which is what we see in certain numbers of games. Square Enix with Final Fantasy has done something similar, and you can see this as they progressed from Final Fantasy 4 and 6 on the Super Nintendo to 7, 8, and 9 on PlayStation, and then for 10, and all the way up to 15, where we would say the same thing. Final Fantasy 15, their characters look very realistic in a lot of detail sense, but if you look at their faces and the way that they're proportioned and rendered, it still looks very anime. Just
Well, that's why I'm really, really glad you just brought up Final Fantasy IX, because that was buzzing in the back of my brain. And that is really another one that's really big that hit me like, wow, anime is really doing its thing. Because look at seven, and obviously it's anime inspired, but then look at eight, and eight had a more of a realistic Western feel to it, you know? But then
Right.
when nine came out, it's nine. This kid has a freaking monkey tail.
Yeah, and Nine also, they went with a very unique art style. The characters' faces are very different and not really in any sort of classic anime art styles, as we do see a lot of similarities between certain art styles, but like you said, Akira Toriyama, like you know when you see the Dragon Ball art style, you don't mistake that for anything else. Or more recently with the Ni no Kuni series borrowing the Ghibli art style
Oh,
for
yeah.
their games.
Yeah, certain things are just unmistakable. And those are the things that resonate with you the most. Like, I know this. Like, you can't deny it. You know what I mean?
Yeah. And to speak of another game that just uses an anime art style, and I know we're skipping around a lot of games that actually would be based off of anime at this point, is Kingdom Hearts. The characters with that, and it must be mentioned how well they pulled off, because the original Kingdom Hearts characters such as Sora, Riku, and Kairi, how they blend so well with the Disney aesthetics, and they managed to find a way to still make these characters look cohesive standing next to each other, even though they're completely different art styles, or at least not from completely different art cultures. Or even when in Kingdom Hearts 2, they brought in the Pirates of the Caribbean world, which was a live action property and the first live action property to be brought into Kingdom Hearts. The Tron was also invited in that game as well, but Tron is decidedly it's very special effects heavy, so it's not hard to suspend disbelief and take a more animated approach to what the way those characters could be rendered in a video game. But Pirates of the Caribbean is decidedly live action. And the way they were able to make Sora, Donald, and Goofy by simply grunging up their textures and darkening the color tones, and also the way they were able to succeed with just making Jack Sparrow and those characters look just enough like their characters to make you go, whoa, like they did it.
And I hate to cut you off, I'm sorry. The reason why it worked so well, if you paid attention to Kingdom Hearts, and I realize who I'm talking to when I said that, but if you pay attention to Kingdom Hearts, the franchise or the team behind the development of that game has always did a very good job of blending, and which is why it works, Eastern and Western styles of animation and digitized animation. So, and yeah, I mean, you can tell just by looking at the characters. It's like, okay, very Western. At the same time, very Eastern, the big giant oversized feet, the oversized eyes, facial expressions, things like that. And which works well with a lot of the live action properties, a lot of the Disney properties, and a lot of the Final Fantasy properties. It gives it that same lighthearted anime aesthetic that you can use to, I don't know, propel the story forward. So, yeah.
Yeah, I would say Disney's art style shares a lot of similar philosophies with Japanese anime art style. They just approach them in two different ways. And of course, we're talking about animation and drawing in general, and it's just different cultures of that. And how I wanted to pose the question of, you know, what is it about anime? Do you know, or do you have an opinion on why the anime art style appeals to you personally? Because I was giving that a lot of thought too, compared to other art styles or realism. And what is it about that that you find appealing, either both in the medium of anime itself or as an art style for video games?
Well, as a person who knows his way around a pen and pad and a brush and a canvas, it's when I first saw or when I first seen anime just in itself, it boosted the limit on my imagination. There's a certain way of storytelling and animation that combines that it was crazy. And when I seen it, it was early on. I'm talking Dragon Ball and Astro Boy. And what was it? Cyborg 009. The way they told the story and the way the animation itself, the freedom and expressions of being able to, well, listen, the proportions are off here, but it works. And it was just amazing to me. And it captivated me in such a way that it's drawn me to anything that reflected that. So it definitely, and video games started like incorporating it, and it's this freedom you couldn't get from traditional storytelling in like movies, television shows, or even some forms of Western animation. It's just they weren't vivid enough, if that made any sense.
So you're saying it's you've grown a fondness more because the art style is associated with these new elements of storytelling and composition. Is that accurate?
That is extremely accurate.
Okay. Which is interesting, because that's a different perspective from where I was going to approach it, which is the actual look of the art. For me, I think anime achieves a very efficient sense of beauty and consistency. What I've noticed in myself, that for the reason I tend to enjoy anime video games or video games that tend to go towards a more abstract animated art style in general, is that the less detail you try to put in, the easier it is to make everything look consistent. And that has to tie in with the technical constraints. But with that less detail also comes less imperfection, and just this idea of beauty from that cleanness and the lack of imperfections. Not that you can't implore more detail, as I mentioned with Final Fantasy XV and Tekken, tons of detail in those characters, and they're still beautiful with idealized proportions and features, for sure. But when we go to more the flat cell shading of traditional 2D anime art style, there is beauty to it. It's the essence of those shapes that appeal to our primordial senses of what it is. The big eyes, the round faces, etc. They just tap into those senses so effectively with such little detail. And I think that might be the reason, is because it's such little detail. So your brain only focuses on the raw input and the raw point. Kind of like the old adage of how, you know, people see what they want to see. And like, you might look at yourself in the mirror and see a pimple, but other people look around when they're talking to you and see like they they're not paying attention to that because they're paying attention to the big picture. They only see, they're only interpreting so much. And I think anime kind of is that art style that was developed and really honed in on just what do people focus on and pay attention to. And for video games, I think that allows for the simple shapes of like trees and foliage to mix very well with both the characters and designs. Not that you can't have super designed characters or really detailed backgrounds, as I've said, but when you have those art styles, I think it just, it does feel a certain way. I agree. And I think that's because of the way the art lacks detail and is just focused in on the simple shapes and key features of human and other anatomy in nature that our brains are developed to notice. What do you think of that?
I mean, that definitely is a different approach than what I was thinking, but you're not necessarily, I wouldn't say it's wrong. Like anything, art forms are suggestive, like anything else. And anime is definitely an art form, whether you're a fan of it or not. So there's no wrong way of looking at it. And if that's the way you see it, then I can agree with definitely certain points that you landed on.
Right. And to put a more specific example, when it comes back to the video games, it's like the argument where if you look back at some of those sprite-based video games, like even Breath of Fire 3, if you look at the in-game art for that and it's more animated stuff, that holds up a lot better over time than games that tried to be more realistic. And, you know, we can use examples of like how Final Fantasy VIII, like its graphics didn't necessarily hold up, but that's because of technological limitations. And if Square could have achieved what they did with Final Fantasy XV in VIII, they would have done it. We can also see that in other games where if the more detail they try to put in there, the more it tends to stick out to us just how dated those games look and how limited by technological advances they were.
Agreed.
And that's just my thought process on the technical level. And so that's where I want to bring us to talking about video games that are based off of anime. And Bandai Namco has been pioneering this. But that first game, that real wow moment where I felt that they started to get anime right using 3D models. And I think you might know which one I'm going to say. Can you guess which one I'm going to say?
Man, as much as we enjoy the same games, there's enough differences in the games that we like to play where I can completely be thrown off in the dark. So I'm going to fold on this one. And I know the minute you tell me, I'm going to be like, okay. I'm going to fold. I'm going to wait.
Now there's two super wow moments. And I know the other one you're going to be more familiar with. But the first one, this was PS3 and Xbox, where they finally, and now Kingdom Hearts, as we said, Kingdom Hearts and Dragon Quest VIII, they started to really get out of there. And I'll want to do a quick shout out to Rogue Galaxy, although Rogue Galaxy is not.
Rogue Galaxy was awesome.
But it is yes, it is super dope. It was basically like a Dragon Quest in space. It just didn't quite happen. Oh, shout out to Star Ocean as well. That one's had mixed art series over, has had mixed art styles above that, but you and I know both played Star Ocean Till the End of Time, which was the third Star Ocean.
I played that until the end of time. I will play it tomorrow. I'm going to play it later.
It was a super great game. But the first game that kind of got out of the anime and video games 3D puberty, in my opinion, was Naruto Ultimate Ninja Storm 1. When I saw that first trailer, the way the characters moved, were rendered, and cel-shaded, I thought, holy crap, they did it. They figured it out. And then they only got better over time, till they hit Storm 4, where they started mixing in even more hard lines and special cuts and effects to mimic hard ink lines and manga-level panels with the heavy colors of a full animation, as manga is typically not colored.
I mean,
that was the first wow moment to me. Like, they finally have the technology to do this.
Mine, if I can interject for a second, would have to be the Tales of games.
Yes, and I wanted to bring that up as well.
Like, I love those games, and Tales of Symphonia,
yes.
Games like that. Those definitely I would have to say one of my picks. And I'm like, wow, this is great. You know, you go freeform, you can run around. Definitely Tales of Symphonia, like the original. And games along those lines were definitely it for me, I would have to say.
Yeah. Now, they have had many Tales games, almost as many as Final Fantasy at this point, and Tales is also pioneering better anime art style. Tales, I believe, is not based off of previous anime, though there have been anime adaptations of the different installments. And they use anime cutscenes, at least anime intros and some cutscenes within the games. I played through Tales of Symphonia. It's the only Tales game I've played through all the way so far. But the characters were still kind of chibi looking on the map and in battle. At least it was consistent in that regard, but they didn't yet have the technology to render the characters at full detail as you would expect if they were like drawn in a show. And you can compare that directly to the opening. So that's kind of what I was getting at, is like these characters actually looked like they were supposed to in the show or off the comic. So that's where like my wow moment. But I agree with you, because Tales has gotten a lot better and has achieved that point as well. It's also a Bandai Namco property, although they're developed by a different studio, but it's under that same umbrella.
But you're right. You're absolutely right. Looking at it that way. And I completely slipped. So we're talking specifically about games that are based on anime and whether or not they hit the mark.
Oh, we can go back and forth. I was just trying to move towards it because we talked about a lot of video games that just used anime art style. So I was kind of trying to give it the
So
other attention.
if we're gonna go by games that are based on, and it just popped in my head, you may not remember it. It's an early Capcom title, and it was Nintendo. It was one of my favorite games. Oh God, what was it? It was Little Nemo's Dream Master.
Oh, I've heard of it, but I've not seen it.
Little Nemo's Dream Master was one of the first games based off of anime. One of them, like super early on, and obviously the graphical limitations of the Nintendo didn't let you get it all the way out there, but they tried. They tried really, really close, and it was a really good game.
And so, in what regard was that a wow moment for you?
No, I wouldn't say that was a wow moment. It was definitely one of the moments that made me take notice.
Oh, okay.
Hey, I'm trying to remember the game. I think it was Xenogears.
Xenogears is another one. Yep.
I think Xenogears was another. I wanted to say Xenosaga, but that's a different game. Xenogears was definitely a good game in regards of the wow moment. It was a lot of action. It was around the time that I was really into Gundam as well.
Yes, there have been many Gundam games.
Many Gundam games
And
is an understatement. There is.
now it is funny because Gundam is a unique one because they rarely, to my understanding, actually render the pilots, which are the most anime part, the robots, which I don't feel, that's where I don't feel there's so much of an issue of them looking like they were drawn or in a, yes, because technically, what we're talking about here is how closely do these things look like they've been hand drawn? So we're getting at for the or what I'm getting at for the anime wow factor. But so with the suits, it's been fine if they're 3D or 2D. They've always been they're very angular. They're very easy to put into 3D, and they've always looked pretty good. But yeah, that's one of those ones that's kind of gotten away because they could just do the cutscenes or the little 2D cuts of the pilots and just put in lip flaps and get away with looking very anime-ish because their robots are much easier to render from a technical standpoint, and they kind of just skip the whole trying to make the pilots look anime. Although now they do have the technology to do that, and I'm actually going to bring up a game that kind of treads on that territory a little bit later. Moving forward on that, the next wow moment in terms of trying to make games look like make a 3D game look like they're flat. The next wow moment, in my opinion, that just showed where it is, and of course, the Metalware must be pointed out for the way it does, but it's a very unique style of anime. Like I said, very watercolor. That's not quite the same as mainstream anime styles. And I'll give you another shot at guessing what game am I talking about that was like the one where, holy crap, they did it again. We can now have anime fully in video games using 3D models. Trying to think if I can give you a hint without giving it away. Duel one.
Guilty Gear?
Guilty Gear Xrd. When Xrd's first trailer came out, and you couldn't tell it wasn't
I
two
was
that it wasn't
thinking
3D.
Guilty Gear.
Yeah. Guilty Gear Xrd was that next moment for me where it's like, they did it. And just about every critic that I heard from raved about it as well and really took notice that Arc System Works had figured out how to technologically take their 3D models and achieve this flat, hand-drawn, almost sprite-esque design. And it had to do with a lot of custom technology where they were literally going frame by frame and drawing in imperfections. And they said specifically in a GDC talk, I believe you can look up on YouTube, going over the art style is part of it to make it look hand-drawn and convincing to people is you need imperfections. And therefore, we go through frame by frame, use some of those techniques such as like animation smears, drawing lines that aren't perfect, having those imperfections, and that's really what sells it, and doing it on a frame by frame and keyframe basis to make sure that things don't look 3D, that we're trying to always make it look 2D. So it takes a lot of extra work, but it's very achievable, and there has been a lot of other games at this point that start to look a lot more like anime. And as you mentioned, like Tales, there's the upcoming Tales of Abyss, I believe is the next game.
Oh, I am aware.
And that one just recently got delayed, but that also looks super beautiful. And I'm super excited for when they've got more information on that one. Oh, they're working on Scarlet Nexus right now. Bandai Namco is putting out, which looks also super beautiful. And I can't wait to play that one. But I wanted to ask about your favorite anime game and see to transition in and be like, do you want to see more games like this, or do you want to see, you know, what kind of anime games have you played thus far, and what genres have you seen, and what genres would you like to see? So why don't you first tell us about your favorite anime video game?
I don't know if this counts, because the anime was made after the game.
Oh, no, no, I meant that. Like, it is an anime, it is not based on an anime, but your favorite anime-styled video game.
Oh, then you already know. You
I
know,
I want you to tell the audience about it.
It is Disgaea. It will always be Disgaea in the history of ever and ever.
Yes.
Always. Always Disgaea. Will never stop.
So tell the people about Disgaea's gameplay and, you know,
so
what.
So Disgaea started off with a game called Makai Kingdom. Now, Makai Kingdom was the original in the NIS Disgaea series, which would later be called Disgaea and so forth. With the name of that.
Aside, NIS is another one of those companies, kind of like Vanillaware, where they have developed their own distinct anime style, and most of their games pretty much look like that. Like Disgaea, Makai Kingdom, there's one like The 100 Year Witch or something like that. I think I just butchered that title, but you know what I'm talking about. You see an NIS game, you know it's an NIS game.
Yeah, and those are definitely one of those companies where you know it's very distinct. You can't mistake it from anything else. So, yeah, it started off with Makai Kingdom. It is a SRPG, or I'm sorry, SJRPG. It's a very tactical. I in the combat in the game is over the top. It's over the top, just anime shenanigans. You can take a character, throw them into another character. They either explode or there's some weird anime cutscene in between, which you can turn on and off. And I absolutely adore it. I don't know what happened to my brain the minute I played this game, but I became absolutely obsessed with it. And I've played every single Disgaea that has ever come out. I have spent countless hours on these games that I will never get back. Ever. And that's fine. And that's okay.
And let me ask the kind of obvious question here is, and it's okay if or however you want to answer this. Do you feel that it being having an anime art style is part of what initially attracted to you? Or do you believe if the game itself had a different art style, it would be just as appealing?
That is really hard for me to say, considering we will never know what the alternative would look like. I've played plenty of RPGs. But that didn't have the anime art style, which I've loved just as much. But I will definitely say the way the art style is, and the first Disgaea and Makai Kingdom came off PlayStation 2.
Okay.
But I will definitely say the animation and the over-the-topness of the game has definitely won it over, in my opinion, and made it one of my all-time favorites. It is in my top five.
Would you say you find the art style charming?
More comedic and whimsical. I wouldn't say charming. I'm never in a bad mood when I play that game. Even if I hit a wall and there's an enemy I can't beat, and I'm ready to throw my controller into, I am ready to Terry Bogard's hat my controller. I'm throwing it into orbit, and it will never come down. But no, I enjoy the game thoroughly, and it always makes me my smile always put me in a good place.
Great. And so the anime game I want to shout out, which is actually a unique series in terms of its relationship with anime, is the Dot Hack series. Now, Lawrence, how many of the Dot Hack games have you played?
I have played two of them. I am not a fan.
Which two do you play? Did you play? If you were,
I played the original, and then I played. What was that called? Had a different protagonist. What was it called?
The second series, Dot Hack GU.
Yeah.
Okay. So to explain to our viewers what the Dot Hack series is, it was one of the first games to really come out with in an episodic format. Literally, the first game was called Dot Hack Volume 1. I think it was called Infection. I know. I feel so bad.
It's prehistoric sword art is what it is.
In a way, it's definitely a precursor to the isekai genre. But let me just double check because I feel really bad. As there were four volumes, and then there was a second series that also was set up in the volume. So they were almost, they weren't quite full games. And what makes them unique is not only that they tried to mimic an anime art style in the game, but that they also developed, in tandem with it, an anime series. Now, there was like a prequel anime series, and there are independent anime installments, as the Dot Hack universe is interconnected and very cross-media. But with the first set of games, there was not only the game disc. Yes, Dot Hack Infection was the very first one. And this was also a Bandai Namco game, funny enough. It had a disc in it with a 20 to 30 minute episode of an anime as well, which was it going on in the Dot Hack universe. And the way they basically had it was you were playing as a character inside the game or the actual game, and that was one part of the story. And then the anime itself was the part of the story that was taking place outside the game world as a parallel element. So let me explain more cleanly what's going on. Dot Hack is about a worldwide MMORPG that exists inside the semi-modern world at the time, for the late 2000s, or the early 2000s, I should say. And so the adventure takes place where you're playing as people who play this game and are experiencing the story while inside the MMORPG. And then the anime that is bundled with it was following people who were inside that world, but they weren't inside the game. They were just the real people outside the game. So while you were the game, and that was part of the funny gimmick that this game was trying to be, was it was trying to be a simulated MMORPG. You played it full single player, but the game itself had all the trappings, or it was like a solo JRPG with elements that harkened back to the way that MMOs would work. You form parties, you go on raids, you level up. And this is old world MMORPGs, not necessarily new ones. You went on various quests, and its most unique feature was the randomly generated dungeons. So you would type in three passwords, and then based on the words that they were, and there were specific passwords that spawned unique dungeons, but there, a lot of it was recycled assets and then just reformed into different ways. So you'd go to the gate, choose from three lists of keywords that would grow and spawn different types of areas and grow over the story. You'd pick those three, it would randomly generate a type of world, which would be within a certain level difficulty, certain type of monsters, certain type of arena aesthetic, and maybe certain types of traps or things like that. But it wasn't too sophisticated, as it had to be a small enough game, and they were randomly generated, so it recycled a lot of stuff. But that was also a very interesting conceit, and they kept building on that as it went forward. So it, in and of itself, is kind of like a mixed-media RPG aspect, and even the second series, it was still on the PS2, both series were on the PS2, they had other anime adaptations that both were actually precursors and parallels to the story, while also being themselves their own installments alongside. It was so wild. It's such a unique experiment. It's really sad to see that they didn't continue it, especially now with the whole isekai genre. You could really see them do another Dot Hack, but the lore of that game, it kind of reached a metaphorical dead end when it came to the way that worked. So it kind of makes sense that didn't play out. So that's the one I wanted to highlight. But as we've kind of gone over, you kind of see the pattern. Most anime games and games that are based off of anime have been either RPGs, fighting games, or some sort of offshoot of RPGs. Very rarely do we see like an actual straight up action adventure game that's anime styled. Even Disgaea is a turn-based tactical RPG and not necessarily something else like that. And so,
Well, I mean, wouldn't you consider Heavenly Sword kind of in that genre?
no, I would not consider Heavenly Sword inside that. It's art, while it certainly can feel very anime, like I don't take away the comparison that you're trying to make, because its art style is definitively not anime and it's not based off a previous anime property, I would not say it makes sense.
So you would feel the same about Asura's Wrath?
Asura's Wrath is definitely an anime game, and that's one of the few examples outside of that. So that was a great example right there. Oh, also, I would be remiss if I didn't mention a game such as the visual novel genre, as there are many visual novel games that use anime art.
Oh, you mean dating sims? Okay.
Both dating sims and visual novels, which dating sims are typically an offshoot of visual novels, or dating sims become an element of gameplay inside of other things, such as with, I don't know if there's actually a dating sim aspect in Disgaea. I know you've talked about there's the court mechanics that have been in there, and that's a different unique thing, right? Tell people a little bit about the court system.
Oh, the court. Huh. You mean court as an actual jury or court as in pursuing?
Yeah, I remember you telling me how you had to like you could get gameplay buffs and nerfs by giving
Yes.
gifts to judges and essentially playing in-game politics.
Yes. In-game politics, you can bribe people who are in charge of, like, just say you needed to raise funds that the or lower the store prices or increase the inventory and the items that they have. You can bribe. First, you have to vote. And if they don't vote in your favor, you can bribe them with money, or you can bribe them with gifts to make sure they vote in your favor. If that doesn't work out and you're confident enough in your level and skills, you can take it by force, which is a crazy system. And anybody who has never played Disgaea, definitely do not become as obsessed as I am, because then you would need help. But definitely play it and enjoy it, or at least try it out.
Yeah, if you enjoy tactical, turn-based tactical RPGs, that is definitely a very unique one with a lot of unique mechanics, and it allows for near infinite number go upness. So,
Oh, the
yeah.
level cap is ridiculous. I believe my last run through of Disgaea 5, it was 7,000.
Okay, and I think they advertised for Disgaea 6, which is the newest iteration that will be coming out on Nintendo Switch currently at this time.
You know
I
when?
think it's
I'm sorry to interrupt.
I don't know if it had an actual release date, and I think we talked about it before. It's also coming to PS4, but currently only for Japan, which I think is just a timed thing. It'll probably be ported over here on PS5. That's my assumption, is they're probably
Oh,
just not.
that's perfectly fine, because I totally buckled and I own a Switch now.
Oh, nice. That's good.
I caved, sir.
That is something we can talk about a bit later on recommendations there, but I'll just say get yourself a nice big juicy mini SD card to fill that, because you'll never need another one. Let's see. Summer 2021 is currently what the official Nintendo page is saying. But if I go to the NIS page.
Well, I apologize for steering the conversation. It's just something that came up,
No,
and
that's fine. It's gonna there's a
I
special
need
edition
to.
that's gonna be $100, so in case you want that. It has a bunch of stuff there. I can send you the side thing if your wallet can handle it. Yeah, I'll look for the information. I think they said it is going to come to yes, it is coming to PS4 in Japan, so it'll probably come to PS5 here as a thing instead of being cross-gen. Or maybe it's just taking longer. Who knows? If they signed like a specific deal, or maybe that was their best judgment. But I don't feel like it's going to stay exclusive for forever. So, looking at other games, anime is pretty much utilized in very few genres outside of that. There is the occasional Musou games, the Dynasty Warrior styles. Gundam has appeared in that, but as we mentioned, you making the robots look good inside video games isn't all that difficult, especially because of the way that the robots are styled with a lot of hard edges. But yeah, do you have any feelings about, anime being used out in other genres? Is there a other standout type of game you could think of where you'd like to see anime used.
And any current games, you mean?
It could be either a property that exists as an anime or just a type of genre that you'd really like to see, like an anime aesthetic and styling used
I would like
for.
to see more of an anime aesthetic and styling done in a Resident Evil game. Maybe that's just me, but I feel like I can do a... Now, when it comes to the horror genre in anime, like it's its own, and forgive the pun, monster in itself. The horror genre in anime is ridiculous. If you want to be up at night, I definitely suggest you do that. And I think that would be a really good thing to apply to the Resident Evil franchise. I just do. Now, for some people, it may take away from the horror aesthetic because it doesn't look as realistic, especially when it has a lot to do with jump scares. But I don't know. I think that would be a really cool thing to try out. Even the House of the Dead
Now that you
series.
mention it, that's actually a good point that there really isn't too many anime horror games. Now, I've seen some indie projects. There's definitely indie horror games out there, and if you go searching, you can pretty much find anything for indie. But yes, there is definitely a lack of AAA games utilizing anime outside of the genres you've mentioned. Now, I do want to make special mention because I'm sure some people may be saying, well, hey, what about like Devil May Cry and Bayonetta? And that's one of those things where, sure, that game is very anime influenced and anime designed, but it's not utilizing the anime art style. I will
Correct.
also throw out there, as this is appropriate, I don't want to discount Fire Emblem. I'm very aware of Fire Emblem, and it too is a turn-based tactical RPG game, much like Disgaea, but they have their own unique trappings. And then Zelda. The Legend of Zelda series has been slowly dabbling further into anime-based styles. Skyward Sword had its own sort of soft, painterly anime art styling, and then they went a lot harder with the bright cel-shaded aspects in Breath of the Wild. So we do see experiments with that. Or to even throw to Okami, which is one of my favorite Capcom games to point out, using it's almost insulting to Okami to say that it's anime style because it's really more of a watercolor painting, but it is a traditional Japanese art style, and it surely is a hearkening to the predecessor of what would eventually be anime art for Japan. So in
Right.
that regards, it is much classier than anime games, which is why I say it. I think it. I might actually be insulting Okami by saying that, but it does look beautiful. And that's one of those things where maybe what are we talking about? Like, we've covered most of the basic genres. We don't really see too many shooters either, which is kind of, take it or leave it in terms of my preference for that. But it is true, like you said, like Resident Evil has some shooter elements to it. So here's about the Resident Evil point that you made that is interesting to me as a huge Resident Evil fan. I would agree with you that they should have just shifted to a more anime art style because that'd be really cool. But considering how they have dedicated themselves to making Resident Evil look as realistic as possible and succeeding extremely in Resident Evil 7 and the 2 remake and the 3 remake, and even for Resident Evil remake itself, going more hyper as trying to go as realistic as possible with a certain level of stylization to their characters. I think they've just managed to succeed in creating that art style, hence I don't really mind, and they've always tried to give it that grounded look. And I touched on this in a little bit in our last episode with the movies, how it doesn't really bother me being a live action movie because the game has always tried to basically ground itself with realism in terms of the character designs rather than in some sort of abstraction. Of course, technology and things like that limited it, but their core was to try and be realism, not be animated. It was just kind of a matter of limitations that they didn't fully achieve that realism. And now that they pretty much have, I wouldn't be opposed to seeing that in like a spin-off in like a horror game. But that's where I honestly could take it or leave it, despite the fact that I usually advocate for more animated style games overall. But I was thinking to myself, like, what did I want to see? And it's more so. While I'd still like to see Western RPGs because I do enjoy that, but I was curious if we'd ever see like an open world adventure game that was maybe not dedicatedly an RPG or not a Zelda game. You know, like almost could we ever get like an anime Grand Theft Auto or an anime Assassin's Creed or something like that? And
I'm sorry. You mentioned an anime in Grand Theft Auto, and it just made my brain tickle. It just tickled my brain. Sorry.
yeah, wouldn't that be wild if for that? And that's essentially what I want to see someday is I want to see like a Western studio take their Western sensibilities. Like I would even t would love to see if like Bethesda did like a Skyrim or some of their big open world RPGs, and instead of doing, you know, a real shooting for that realism art style, just get and hire an anime an anime artist team and have them do the art for the game. And I'm not saying really like change it and make it all the Japanese aesthetics. I'm just saying render it like it looks like an anime, but everything else is Western designed. Because there is certain aspects to Japanese games, and that's a wider topic. And anime games are, of course, widely made by the Japanese developers. So there's certain feelings and a aspects to Japanese design that you really feel there that are different from Western, and you can really kind of tell where the what there's like a there's a feel, there's a flavor to anime games that just isn't present in the West. And I think that's part of why I enjoy those games and why the art style is a signal for those things. Kind of like what you were talking about with the with what you appreciate about the art style.
Right, and those are relatively in the same boat. So I agree with you. I agree with you 100%, actually.
Though I'm speaking more to the gameplay necessarily than just the idea of the imagination sparking. And not that to devalue what you were saying, because when you're talking just the when we're talking the animations, I completely agree with you there as
Well,
well.
I'm telling you what draw I'm telling you what's drawn me to it, but what kept me there, obviously, is the gameplay. I mean, because something can look great, and then when you get there, you're like, eh, and then you go back to something else. But, you know, I mean, those things kind of work together for me. It kind of does it for me as a thing.
There's a certain refinement and laser focus to Japanese game design that is admirable. It does lead to certain jank that you don't see in Western games, but Western games have their own level of jank as well, and then there's Euro jank, and it's one of those things where it's hard to drill down to, and maybe that's a future topic we'll get into is the different cultural janks of game design that we get into.
Welcome to Janky Town.
Oh yeah. So I did want to talk about an anime game I was recently playing. I've rented this on GameFly for now, and I'm playing it on my PlayStation 4 Pro. And that's the latest entry in Sega's long-running mech series game, Sakura Wars. Are you familiar with the Sakura Wars series?
I have never played any of those. I, and this is gonna sound really weird. I've been oversaturated with the giant robot genre in animation or in anime for so long. Like, you have to wow me when it comes to like giant robot anime. I'm kind of over it. So if a game is kind of following that whole aesthetic, I purposely run the opposite direction. I think the last game I played that had anything to do with giant robots was White Knight Chronicles.
Oh my God, I wanted to play that one so bad, but I heard it was just not that good. They eventually remastered it, and I think it was okay, but I never got a chance to play it.
It was okay, sir.
It was okay. Great. So with Soccer Wars, I would say it's okay. But with a little more positive emphasis. I'm like, it's okay. Because, first off, whatever Sega does for rendering their anime faces, it's another separate wow moment. It's not as big as Guilty Gear or that time in Naruto. But it is, you look at the characters and they just look like anime faces. The eyes are perfectly well done. They even have some line work done in the face. It's gentler, like the way the nose is shaped. The mouth is lip synced, and it's only Japanese with subtitles, which is a little problematic in a few spots, but overall it's fine. I prefer dubs myself, but I will definitely deal with subs when it is the only option. It is just the way the characters move and emote and just the look. It is definitely, I feel like it's one of those things where we're here. You can take the anime art style and correctly translate it to a video game. And not that it looks hand-drawn. It keeps the mystique or that charm, I should say, of the 2D drawing, but properly translates it into a 3D model, and it just looks right at every angle, or just about every angle from what I'd say. So I'd recommend you look up some cutscenes on that, Lawrence, and just take a look at the characters. Now, I'm not actually a fan of their robot designs. The robot designs are like these little stumpy steampunk style robots. And so that kind of turns me off from my sensibilities. I'm much more of a fan of the Gundam angular styles, but they're fine. And it's funny because it's contrasted where when you play as the robots, that's really, in my opinion, the meat of the game because that's when it turns into like an action style beat 'em up. And it's actually kind of fun. It's very rudimentary combos at the moment, but I've only played like the first two missions, I think, of combat, and even then it wasn't that much. It's a very weirdly paced game. They basically make you do like a big social game section where you're talking to people and you're in a theater, and that's kind of the front for the military operation. And each military department, or each squadron, I guess you'd say. I don't know the correct military term, so forgive me, any of our military listeners. Each like platoon or squadron has their own like public face, and for this it's an Imperial theater, it's called the Imperial Theater, and they put on plays, the pilot women put on plays to help boost morale in town and stuff. But then you jump into these stubby robots and then they fight demons, and the demons, like, I don't know if they're part mechanical or if it's just this weird mech armor, but they're like part organic and then have this weird armor built on them. It's very interesting visual design. And that's where it's like, oh, you do. There is a dating sim aspect to it.
Sorry.
I'm not very fond of it, but the way I've decided to play it, at least for my trial period, because I'm not super invested in it, there's usually three dialogue choices. And you use the left stick and you choose up, down, left, or right. And I just decided I'm just going to pick left at all times. And I've deemed that the canon pathway. So no matter what's there, I pick left. Unless it's like one of those binary choices where it's kind of like a yes, no, or like, hey, are you going to proceed? Because you hit stopping points where it's like, oh, do you want to start the story mission or do you want to keep exploring the social space? And so I'll just go, oh, well, I'm ready to move on to the mission. So of course that's on the right, so I'm going to pick the right choice. Or if it's something that's deliberately affecting the gameplay. But most of the choices are based on endearing your avatar character, and it is an actual character, towards the other girls and building relationships. And they say there's like the trust mechanic, in which case you can get little trust sequences where you have heart to hearts with the characters, kind of Tales of Symphonia-ish, or I should say Tales of, because all the Tales games have that a similar feature like that. But you can have like these one-on-one sessions you earn, or there might be special events, I think, in battle that can also happen based on that. But I always choose left, and that has led to a very entertaining experience where sometimes the character says exactly the right things, and his name's Kamiyama. It's an actual dude, and he speaks and stuff, so you're picking his choices. But I think that doing that is I've had a lot of fun with because I feel like that is the intended character. Instead of me turning this game into like a dating sim, I'm avoiding the dating sim aspect and be like, what just happens if I just let Kamiyama be himself? And sometimes he puts his foot in his mouth, and sometimes he's very negative, and it's very funny to see. Well, they clearly want me to pick the ideal Kamiyama by picking up or left or up or right, and I just pick this one, and he's just eh. He sometimes says the wrong thing, and sometimes one girl likes it, and some girls other. And seeing like my idea of what this canon path is, where I don't really have a choice, and seeing
Right. Well, that's
how
just
the game
life.
actually reacts to that.
I think that's just life. And I think that's an aesthetic I really like. It's like, okay, I'm going to say a boneheaded thing. Somebody may like it, somebody may not. That's kind of how I work.
Yeah, and I thought about that because I haven't really played dating sim games. Once I had this idea, I thought about maybe playing a dating sim game at some point and having this experiment, which is, what if I actually played it like I was actually trying to date someone in real life, where instead of trying to say the right thing to impress my chosen waifu, I'm like, well, does their personality actually make sense to me? And I'll pick dialogue choices based on what I'd want to say
I don't
and
know if
what
that'll work out,
happens.
Senpai.
Exactly. And that's what I'd be very curious to see because obviously you might pick certain characters, and even in Sakura Wars, there are certain characters I find way more attractive than the other. I have my favorites of the girls. But how that might line up with the dialogue choices and whether or not Kamiyama actually matches up with that.
Well, the thing about dating Sims and real people is, okay, even though it's pretty much like you have a certain type and then have a certain personality type, and you literally have to say the right thing or your story won't progress. The only difference in that in real life is that you have that X factor. And that X factor is those outside situations that may sway a person's opinion of you. You know, you could you could talk to a woman at a coffee shop and then talk to her at a bar and about the same subject, and the scenery itself can be the thing that makes her like you or not.
Yeah. And from what I can tell, Sakura Wars at least seems to let you fail forward. It's just a matter of, well, which girl is going to end up liking you more. From what I've seen so far, there isn't some sort of detrimental gameplay element I'm going to lose out on by not trying to woo every single girl. And you can't, I don't think you necessarily date all the girls. Like, there's a head captain that you are, that's actually your boss. And while you can flirt with her, it doesn't seem like she'll ever actually be a relationship choice. She's just there and to bounce off of, for her and Kamiyama to interact, and of course her setting the stage around the characters. So I've been subverting the dating sim aspect that way, and I found it very entertaining. And I wonder, I'd have to find the right dating sim game to try there. And of course, there's a whole bunch of new types of dating sims, not just Japanese ones. So to digress, well, getting back to different anime genres that we may want to see there, do you have a specific dream project you'd love to see, whether that's a specific type of game? And I know you mentioned the Resident Evil horror or a horror style game anime, but is there a specific anime you'd like to see adapted, and how would you adapt that into a video game? Or
there are plenty of animes actually I would love to see as a game if they can do it correctly.
Mm-hmm.
I would like to see a My Hero MMO. Is where it's almost like they've done something similar, but I would like to see a My Hero MMO. You got a set in the city, you have your villains and your heroes, you can do a basic power set that can grow as you do. You know, because you already have your types of quirks. You have your enhancement, and then you have your speed or your flight or whatever it is you do. And you can do that with My Hero, or you can even do it with One Punch, because there's a very similar formulas that style of game would actually work with. DC Universe.
I was going to bring that up.
Yeah, DC Universe did something according to that. And
you basically want the My Hero version of DC Heroes.
Or even a My Hero RPG, which would be good. I don't think that would be a bad thing to do, even though, yes, obviously we know the story. You can do an independent story.
Would you want it to be action, turn-based, or tactical, like Disgaea?
Kind of like the Tales games. You know, you can either have
a choice. Like a mix of the two?
Yeah, you can make it turn-based, or you can just go for a free-for-all, where you have to pay attention to your characters, you can do what it is you have to do. You can team up with different heroes.
Well, I think the Tales games have trended to being full action games. They had the weird conceit where they do the battle transitions, like you'd be on the world map, you'd run into an enemy, and then it would take you to a separate space to fight, but it was still like real time. So
you can switch that in the option to make it turn-based.
Oh, really? Okay. Which game was that?
I believe one of the most recent Tales games. Because they give you an option when it goes, easy, super easy, or regular for people who are more advanced or not more advanced. Star Ocean's the same way. You can either make it turn-based or not turn-based.
Oh, I played Star Ocean until the end of time, and I definitely wanted to play that. I played that as an action style.
Final Fantasy 15 also has that option.
Well, I think you're splitting a little bit of hairs there on the Final Fantasy 15 part, because it's sort of turn-based, but it's still all real-time. It's just like, do you want to control your character with the left stick or not?
Well, what I mean by that, it literally in that little AP grid, there's this thing you get to max out, which stops and pauses the game for each decision that you make.
Oh, right, yeah. That's more like an assistive feature, but you're saying, or I guess, did you play the Final Fantasy VII Remake demo?
I have not, and I refuse to until the other part comes out.
Parts, probably.
Parts, but I need at least one more part.
Well, I did play the demo myself, and so what they do, they have a system where you can pause to pick certain actions from the menu, although you can also set hotkeys, or you can navigate the menu almost kind of Kingdom Hearts style in real time, which I did appreciate, so it's almost semi-turn-based, kind of like what they were doing with 15. So I understand what you're saying is you want sort of like a mix in there. So, okay, I could see that.
Go ahead.
No, go ahead. Finish your thought.
Like I said, there are plenty of anime I would love to see just made into... what am I watching now? Tower of God would make a great RPG. I think it would make a beautiful one. You already got the structure set where here's the thing you do, here's the goal, and now you have to reach it. You have to become strong enough to do so. So Tower of God is great. God of High School make an awesome fighting game.
Yeah.
That would make an amazing fighter.
And you want specifically like a 2D style fighter, because when we were talked about fighting games before, you're not very fond of the arena fighters, which is what most of the animes get turned into.
I know.
Yeah. Other than, and I mean, it took us this long before Arc System Works was finally tapped, a real fighting game studio, and we got Dragon Ball Fighters, which, while not your ideal Dragon Ball fighting game, it's the closest thing to it since when we played Budokai 3.
Yeah, I just feel like the arena fighters are fine, I guess. They took a thing that worked and they just ran with it. I mean, they ran with it.
It's a spinoff of the thing, and I get where they're going. And we don't have to rehash our conversation. People can go back and listen to the previous episode on fighting games for that. I feel like
me
a bad host.
Me no likey, sir.
Because I don't remember the number, but I'm going to try and say the exact name with looking at it. So that would be, you could go back to episode 5, where me and Lawrence talked about the future of fighting games and how we envisioned it, if you want to learn more about Lawrence's feelings on arena fighters. So for me, it's funny, I was also going to say My Hero Academia, because I've been playing the new Marvel's Avengers game, which I thought was going to be way more trashy than it actually is, and while it's still rife with a certain number of technical bugs and a lack of content, it is an evolved looter beat-em-up, and you could totally take that format, especially in co-op, and the way the characters can combo. I would like to see the powers and or quirks, as they're called in My Hero Academia or Boku no Hero for the Japanese, those who prefer the Japanese title. I would definitely think you could take that, and it makes a lot of sense, and with the different character classes, especially with paying respects to the different versatilities of the powers and the way that grow. I would love to see a beat-em-up or some sort of action-adventure like that, where you take Deku or maybe some of the other characters and you can switch between them and use their quirks to solve puzzles. I'm trying to think of a different anime at this time, because that was there. And I know Naruto had a myriad of other video games where they did experiment with some adventure games, oddly enough. And then there are some non-fighting anime games out there as well, not just the dating sim or visual novel styles. And so I'm missing a couple there. If I had to...
That's a Naruto, I know. A Naruto dating sim called Love Hinata. That's funny.
I know. I'm going to throw back hard, and I think you're going to agree with me. Now, I haven't really played Uncharted, but I have played Last of Us, Part 1 and Part 2. So, and the two are similar, except Last of Us is much slower paced, and Uncharted is the more action style of these, like, highly structured action-adventure games. What they should do is they should make Cowboy Bebop game, like Uncharted, where it's just a random adventure somewhere inside the series that takes place somewhere inside the series with Spike and Faye, and they go, and you just have a mini-adventure in the Cowboy Bebop universe, but it's structured like an Uncharted game. That would be amazing.
I think it would be structured more like Rogue Galaxy.
Well, no RPG, no level, no experience, no points, no grinding, just a straight adventure game. I don't want any of that in there.
Okay, all right.
That's what I'm saying. Like, I want it to just be straightforward. You get your gameplay mechanics, play through the stages, you do your quests, and it's just a linear story.
You know what? I can agree with that.
Yeah, that's the thing where I think we have so many games with RPGs, and it ends up, I'm not really fond of grinding. I recently stopped playing Genshin Impact because it hit a point where it was requiring way too much time to level up and progress the character just to move on to the next.
Well, if I'm
going to
interject on that game specifically, like, the way they did their leveling up process is kind of ridiculous.
It was backwards from what traditional RPGs do.
Yeah, it was super weird. Now, you know me, and Disgaea is one of those games where you can grind. They actually encourage it because you need to unlock certain things. I don't mind grinding if I can see the point of doing it. I definitely don't. Like, sometimes certain games are definitely more tedious than other games. I'll give you that much. But the way Genshin Impact did it, it's you actually fighting monsters, grinding, spending hours running around. It just wasn't worth the hassle.
Yeah, you didn't. The experience points you got from actually beating like standard monsters, although you could run around forever and defeat standard monsters, was a pittance. The most got was probably a dozen, and while the world level could go up and other aspects could increase that, you were expected to collect scroll items that had tons of experience points attached to them, but then it wasn't enough to just have those scrolls to give to your characters. You also had to pay from the in-game's standard currency of coins or gold, and this is, you don't pay for this. So while there is ways to pay to get the premium currency that you could turn into that, it was the standard currency, which you could get in oodles, but you'd burn through it because you had to use that to level up your character, and you could get dozens of characters. That was part of the gimmick of the game. You had to use it to level up your weapons, and you always were not only searching for materials but also the money. And to me, that's just overcomplicating the system, and the whole point that they were trying to do is make you waste your time, so you have to keep engaging with the game, so eventually you spend money. Whereas that's not what I'm looking for. And it's funny enough, the gacha element to it, the loot box element to that game, was the least annoying part. And it's literally the leveling up, because it's like, you need to be this level, or you start it, once the world level went up and the enemies kind of scaled with you, the enemy scaled to a point where it was just way higher, and they just felt like meat shields, and the gameplay wasn't as, I should say bullet sponges, but they're just damage sponges, excuse me. It just, the gameplay felt kind of stiff. There was a whole bunch of other elements there. It's just like, you know what? The game is not letting me progress naturally enough, and I'm starting to do all the grind stuff, and it's really just to barely get enough to push that next step forward. I don't want to do this.
Agreed.
And honestly, I don't think paying for it actually would have done much other than using crystals to get a boatload to turn it eventually to convert to coin. And even then, I think they had like caps and limits. And I didn't want to do that. That's not it. There's plenty of other better games. So, trying to think. So, there are other games that experiment with anime, but I just want to see more. And I think like a straight up action adventure game like Uncharted would be great. I think your idea of a horror game, though, I'm trying to think of what horror game, what anime would be a great horror one. I haven't watched too many scary horror style games. I wish I was more familiar with what type of game the I think Soul Eater actually had like an action adventure game that was only in Japan and on the Wii. I don't know if that actually had RPG elements to it, but I wouldn't be surprised if it did. Tokyo Ghoul. I know Tokyo Ghoul recently got a game, and I think that's more of an action game. I'd have to double check on that. But something like, you even brought up Asura's Wrath. Like, that's what I'm looking for more of. I think there is some anime racing games and things like, oh, IGPX. I need to bring that up. I love that, watching that on Toonami. And then they did release one game that was on the PS2. I think I got to look up, try and see if I can find that online and try and play that for a little bit. It was probably jank, but it would be cool to say that. But that, yeah, like even like that, like a robot type racing game or something fun like that. And I know some of the Gundam games take the Gundam games have kind of carried on what was started with Virtua. Oh, now I'm blanking on the name. Correct me. What is the robot fighter that Sega created? Virtua On.
Yes.
That's it. Virtua On was what I was thinking of. So you can go on.
Sorry. I was just thinking about, as I was listening to you, I was thinking about horror anime. And I know you're not too familiar with the genre, but there are a couple out there. Like there was an action horror called Tokyo Majin. And Tokyo Majin was one of those anime series. It's really good. It's action and horror. You get your group of kids, you know, like any standard anime, your group of kids, special abilities, and they use to fight demons. And like these demons are Tokyo Ghoul type demons. It's really good. It's really involved story. And that would make a really good game. It's not a fighter. You got, I don't know, JoJo's Bizarre Adventure even. It started off serious enough.
Oh, yeah. And let me bring up two more things that make me feel really silly. Oh, yeah. There's also like dance rhythm games. There's Persona Dancing All Night, which, you know, shout outs to those. That's pretty cool in those divergent genres. But I'd be remiss if I didn't mention like Freedom Wars, which was essentially an anime-styled Monster Hunter-style game. I think I could definitely get into the Monster Hunter style game if it was just a little less grindy, a little more quality of life. I'd love to see a Western studio do a take on that. And once again, I would really love to see a Western studio do their Western design and then, or their Western game design, but add Japanese anime style art on top of it just to give it that distinct visual flair. But I could definitely get into the Monster Hunter genre if it was a little more quality of life and less genre, because taking on giant monsters of some kind and co-oping with your friends definitely is like something I want to do. The other thing I want to mention is an action adventure game that is based on an anime but is using an anime art style, and that would be Gravity Rush 1 and 2, which are exclusive to PlayStation. And those games were phenomenal. And I, with PlayStation 5 having its game boost mode, I'm thinking I might go back and try Gravity Rush 2 at 60 frames per second, as long as it works, and experience that game at the smoothest, because that right there is an example of, oh my god, they did a very nice genre and they just had some anime stylings to it, and it felt very fresh, and it has everything about it, about a game that I enjoy.
I'm agreeing with you. I apologize. Like, I didn't realize you were waiting for me to respond other than I agree. And I do. I don't have any notes to contradict anything you just said. Like, I think you explained that beautifully.
Thank you very much. And you've made some great points today. As always, we've had a ton of fun. So before we sign off, I just wanted to ask if there was any other specific notes you wanted to bring up about anime video games.
The only thing I honestly have to say is, if any anime developers for games are listening right now, please learn from the past. We have had a lot of bad games, and re-releasing a bad game or not fixing the bugs in the previous ones isn't the way for us to just get over it. We've come way too far to make the same mistakes. But we've had a great run with a lot of games, and I enjoyed a lot of them, even if they aren't America's favorite games, Japan's favorite games, or even, speaking of favorite games that nobody likes, what was that game that your cousin likes a lot? The monster game?
Oh, that wasn't anime inspired. That's just like based on kaiju fighting, giant monster fighting. It's called like Monster Destruction or something like that.
So it wasn't anime inspired, but the kaiju genre is definitely from Japan.
Yeah.
And I think I brought that up because the world needs to know it's a horrible game and must be destroyed. Every copy needs to be burned. And then you take the burned copies, which are probably going to be plastic and or rubber. Then you take it and then you launch it into orbit, never to be seen again. I'm not a fan is what the takeaway is.
I don't think I even got the name right. And that's as much respect as it deserves. So we may have to play this sound clip for him because I don't think he listens to the podcast, which is fine. No worries if you're not listening, buddy. We'll share this soundbite with you someday.
No.
But yeah, so my two recommendations.
So far as the anime games, I do like to be surprised. Fortunately, a lot of them has been pleasant, but I do like to be surprised. I like to see what people come up with, and being wowed at first glance is definitely part of it. Getting the thing that you want is enjoyable. It really is. But getting the thing you didn't know you wanted, oh, that's amazing.
Yeah. So then to end this, we'll just leave with what I think are our top four recommendations for offbeat anime games. Not necessarily that they're based on anime, but they at least use the anime art style and are unique in and of the subgenre that I would say is anime games. So my two recommendations would be Gravity Rush 1 and 2 and Asura's Wrath. Though I would say it's probably better to just watch Asura's Wrath on YouTube because there's no real easy way to get it now, and that game is more watchable than it is playable, in all honesty. But Gravity Rush 1 and 2, definitely you should play those. Those are really good. They were both, Gravity Rush 1 came out on PlayStation Vita and then was remastered for PlayStation 4 and runs at 60 frames per second. And Gravity Rush 2 was a PlayStation 4 exclusive, and it's really good. And then based on Lawrence's suggestions, the Disgaea series, for those who are fans of tactical RPGs and want some ridiculous new types of mechanics on top of anime tropes, and Odin Sphere, which is itself a 2D action RPG. And if you're not so much a fan of the RPG aspect, I'd recommend Muramasa the Demon Blade, which is less RPG and more of a 2D action side-scroller, kind of labyrinthy. And for those that don't know, I'm trying to push Labyrinth as the colloquial replacement for Metroidvania, so it's less inside baseball video gamey.
Okay.
But those would be the ones I think are our top recommendations for our listeners out there to give a try if you are interested in seeing some cream of the crop in terms of what unique Japanese anime games can bring you.
Yeah, I think that pretty much says it all.
Well, thank you very much, Lawrence, for joining me again today. We will certainly be together on other topics in the future, and I hope all our listeners out there have a great day and take care of yourself, and I hope you join us on the next one. See you around.
Be easy, guys.